when I met Dominique's brother, actually before that, 12, 15 years ago, because the first time I visited their farm, I bought meat from him at the market, and he went to show me, you know, to show me around the farm, and he stuck his hands in this big sack, a piece of grain, pulled them out, and I took a picture, which I still have, and he said, we start with this. And I never thought of that. As a chef, as a cook, I'd never thought of where did the meat come from. And so they grow on 60 hectares all the grain for their pigs. They are not pasture raised. They are happy pigs. The meat is very dark red, but they're, the pigs are slaughtered at almost a year, 11 months to 12 months, at a weight of 180 to 200 kilos. So this would be like half the size of one of the pigs that they that they slaughter. So
Was it a Gascon, the breed?
No, it's a Yorkshire Landras Duroc mix. Those pigs are used for fresh meat, so chops and roast and sausage, as well as for charcuterie. There's a balance in their products. They make about 26 products every week. 8 to 10 pigs, 12 pigs in the summer. Every week, so over 2 tons of meat are sold at 4 small markets within 25 kilometers of the farm to a population of about 7,000 people. So it's in France, is a system that still works. Fortunately, we still have supermarkets, we have all the bullshit everybody else has. But deep in the pocket in Gascony, we still have some of this tradition. And we were asked to talk about craft, and I was telling Dominique, I said, what's the French word for craft? And we didn't really know, because it's not used in the same way, but the métier, or the work you choose to do, involves being an artisan, an independent person, is a craftsperson, and you maîtrise, or you master your craft by repetition, by practice, and by what you do. Dominique was not a butcher. He grew up on the farm, but he left. He was the oldest son. He got out of Dodge, and he became a teacher at an agricultural school, and then the headmaster of an agricultural school in forestry. But life changed, and he and his wife decided to go back to the farm about 15 years ago, 16 years ago now, and he went back to work with his brothers. So there are 4 brothers, 2 of their wives, working together to do this production as a family, and they sell direct to the consumer. So he practices craft every day, every week, and he's been very gracious to share it with students as well. So he's just going to do a basic breakdown of what he does.
And my production of the meat of the pigs, it's just for the market. It's not a French charcuterie. It's very important to the difference, because I adapt my cut to the consumer. Okay? In French charcuterie, you have a process very...
regimented. Yes. Everything is codified. A pâté de campagne is this. A saucisse de Toulouse does not have garlic. It has this. So they have, but Dominique works to what his market wants.
For example, on the market, I go to sell the head. I sell the pâté, not cook, just pâté to transform. And people take and cook at home. For example, I prepare the loin to the confit, ham to noix de jambon, or ribs. They cut just ribs, and they cook at home. Or I prepare feet, fresh or cook, and people transform at home. Because you have the tradition in the Southwest to cook pig. If you want, on the farm, they have the grandfather and grandmother to grow the pig and take at home the piglets. And grandfather and grandmother died, and people said, yes, we like charcuterie, and they sell at home just half. Or people said, I don't know the preparation of charcuterie, and I prepare chops, loin, or cutlets, and sausage meat, or sausage. and they take to put on the congelator, yes?
So it's like what Adam was saying about the memory, there still exists this very strong food memory of people raising their own pigs on the farm and making their own charcuterie. I worked with my neighbors over the last 25 years doing that with them. And as they stopped people raising one or two pigs on a farm, they would go to their neighbors to have a few, to eventually to people like Dominique's farm who specialize then in just pigs. And they have an organic dairy that's separately run by the next generation, and then they specialize just in pigs.
Okay.
Do your magic. Do your magic.
So the... Vas-y, should I just do the soundtrack? Because we only have 15 minutes. We actually did for, you know, video, and just 7 minutes to break down a 100-kilo side when he's not talking and doing things. It's not never a speedy thing because they work over the week with this 10 pigs. They butcher to sell for Tuesday, for Wednesday, and for Saturday market. So they work them a little out of time.
You said that the pigs were 180 to 200 kilos. Is it alive or slaughtered?
That's a live weight.
Yeah.
But when they hang, they have to take the heads off at the abattoir because they're too long, just be in the truck or in the floor. So they sell all the parts. When we talk about nose to tail, everybody knows what that talks about now. But they actually, you can buy a tongue, you can buy ears raw or cooked, you can buy the beret, which is the stomach, you can buy lungs, and you can buy the spleen, obviously liver, heart, all the parts. They also incorporate those in some products, but we're still in an era where people will cook those at home. They'll saw the hock rather than joint it because when they sell it raw, it's a nice clean, they'll have a nice clean cut across and you don't see the joint because those grandmothers don't want to see any more. People in general don't want to see blood, and they don't want to see like knob ends on bones. They want to see meat. So if you're selling bone in meat, you have to be a little careful of how you do that. The tenderloin has a value, but it's, you know, just one. It goes to the first person. There's never any big fight over it because there are other parts that are more tasty. And as we work in the cutting room, the cutting room is probably the size of a container. It's not a shipping container, but it's about the same size. With three walk-ins off to the side, a sausage drying room. They use two computerized control etudes or fermentation cabinets for making their saucisson. We brought some of the products here, which we'll taste some tonight. But like this is a saucisson, this is a noix de jambon, which comes that we would get about 10 to 12 of these out of one ham, this size.
For example, I prepare my pâté. Pâté is this meat, it's a leftover. Don't use to the sausage. This is meat to sausage, I prepare here.
So they have a weekly cycle of products that start on Monday morning with boudin, the blood sausage. Pâté, which is made from all the trim from last week's meat. So there's never, it's like they, it's just depending on how much is, might be bloody, might be parts that aren't so nice, aren't going to go into fresh sausage. And they prepare those things and they'll do some cooked roast at the front of the week that will sell during the whole week. And otherwise they make sausage and cut fresh along the line. They sheet out the ribs normally. They do one side carcass and they cut chops. They'll cut with a saw. The other they sheet out so that they can have the copa, the loin, the belly for charcuterie.
I cut just here.
So, Dominique, did you cut to the zero joint, the bottom of the lumbar vertebrae, rather than one up? Gets more chops that way. Gets an extra chop or a couple extra inches of loin. So when we teach students, we teach them this method so that they learn about the muscle structure, like what you were describing, and that the, you know, where they separate the for the charcuterie cuts is based on the difference in muscles, not on the bones. They're also going to transform some shoulders will go into mostly into sausage, some will go into roast, some will go into other things, so they sort of parcel out through the week what they need. And you also can imagine with a pig twice the size of this, it's got a lot more weight, so Dominique works with the weight of the pig on the table, and just by pushing it, the weight lets it drop down, and then he just separates out. And when he describes what he's doing, he never uses the word cut or chop. It's always like, you liberate this, you release that. And actually, it's very poetic in that way. But it is it's a way of approaching the breakdown rather than, you know, a brutal way.
Yeah. One thing in Germany, when I have journalists that come, and they were always like, yeah, glass battery, where do they hack? Where do they hack the animals? And we're like, this is not hacking, and then they get it that it's more like a doctor, like splitting it very finely, and then they get the change in the head. So I think it's also the language that we should use about our craft.
Yeah, that's like butcher. You butcher substrate. Right? It's not a very nice.
Yeah, the vocabulary of quality. Mm.
Exactly.
The lexicon of sustainability. That was that project.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
And you have the lol and the copa or charnu or.
Yeah, in French, the copa cut is a chine or charnu. Char is like charcuterie, is fleshy, so it's the meaty. And they do dry it and sell it that way, but we also buy it and cook it as a roast. And I was saying that we work in the butcher room on stainless steel tables, so the students learn to lift as they cut rather than cut down into the meat.
Why?
So that they don't scratch the table or dull their knives.
Why? So why not?
Because it's easier to clean and keep clean the stainless steel tables. They eliminate the whole board business.
It's a euro every time you hit the table with a knife.
1 euro because of his retirement fund. So. In primals, the ham, the shoulder, the head, the loin and copa attach, the belly, and then these will be hung and pulled back and used as they need to cut. They keep intact everything as long until the day they're going to sell it. So the copa will stay on with the loin and that will hang in the cutting room, and the rind will stay on at that point.
The belly. I use, for example, to the market. I just out this.
So with the belly in French, you have ventre, belly, or poitrine, which is your chest. It's not often distinguished so much, but we make a ventre roulée, which is like a pancetta, salted, rolled belly. We also salt and smoke big squares of the belly. Tu veux expliquer qu'est-ce que tu fais avec la ventre?
With this, I put just salt during 3 hours, and after out, and I cut on the market with a machine, like this, like a slice.
Such as for sliced fresh.
Okay, it's possible also out skin.
They have a machine that does that, you know, planing that goes through. So one of the interesting things I felt about their shop was it was very small space, but they had a computerized kettle, oil bath kettle that they cook things in. They use two computerized fermentation cabinets. They have a planer that planes the rind or the fat off. And then everything else is basic, a grinder, a stuffer, and a mixer. And these are all fairly small scale. But where they also have a computerized feeding system for the pigs. It used to take Jack 2.5 hours to feed the pigs a day. Now it's 15 minutes, and he programs it in. So where it's like a real pig, typical pig farm.
Are they
in small country.
Stables?
They're in pens, in the European standard now for pens. There's very little pasture raising in France. There's a big discussions about that, good and bad, but mostly they're in transition from a three-generation farm to modern farm, and probably will not go to the next stage. And in France, it's not a high profile. Pasture raised doesn't even exist in the marketing. People, consumers aren't looking for it. They don't know, they don't care. They want the flavor. So.
How?
How long do you age after death before you cut them?
Every week they bring in fresh meat and they're working overnight. Basically, the pigs are at the slaughterhouse. From their slaughter Sunday, early Monday morning, Sunday night, Sunday they're brought in, they're slaughtered Monday morning early, they stay in the slaughterhouse so the core temperature drops, and then they're brought to the farm usually late Monday night or early Tuesday morning, and then they start working from there. But they have pigs from the previous week that they use for the Tuesday market. So the maximum age, they don't age.
Is there required vet analyzing?
Oh yeah, it all takes place at the abattoir. The abattoir is off the farm, and it's a... It's an improved abattoir where everything is stamped and inspected. Do you want to break down to I say the money for us in and I tell students you'll make your money on these noix de jambon because their time frame for curing, you know, a ham that size maybe 9 months, although larger hams a year to 18 months. But we're talking about a 6-week time frame. So from slaughter to sales, this is about a 6 to 7 week product. And it's not an Iberian ham, and it's not, you know, aged. But we do those two ourselves. But it's a great product. It gets ham on people's plates, and it gives them the kind of rotation. So every 6 weeks, they have a new batch coming through.
Talked about the income for the farming, and then you talked about education. Is that where you have your prime income source from education?
For the farm?
Yeah.
No, it's their sales. Okay. I like to think of myself
as the most important
as, people. No, I'm one of their markets. They do 4 markets a week, and then they do a delivery every 2 weeks into the city nearby. To big businesses like the insurance companies, the big post office in Agen. Christiane takes orders now, it's by email, and then she brings in her car with the coolers and drops meat off in the city. And then, and that's worth a market, sometimes I refer to it. And then when I work with them, with students, it's like I pay them enough that it's like a market. Every week.
But you make a business out of
me?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm a teacher.
Educating.
I'm an educator, teacher,
so
writer.
And it's private courses. So people are coming to you, they're willing to pay for learning how to cut up the
and I facilitate that because mostly they're English speaking. They're not French people coming to me. They're Australians, Americans,
right.
Canadians, South Africans. And then I teach the theory behind.
Yeah.
And also support all the food safety with HACCP. And then we now provide a HACCP certification included in what we're teaching, and I bring in a certified HACCP instructor to teach that. And she teaches a 20-hour course woven into what we do.
But based on French legislation?
No, based on USDA.
Okay.
Because most of my students are
from
the States.
From the
and actually the USDA standards, even in France, the big ham companies are working to USDA standards because they want to export. So HACCP is now universal, so it's just a standard. And I said, instead of fighting it, which I was going to be in a position to fight it, or embrace it and try to incorporate it. And I describe it as we talk about traditions, so you know, I like to play with words, so I said seed to sausage, and then I thought, it's like when you see the old moon in the arms of the new. You see that image of the shadow of the old moon and the new moon. And so we're trying to teach old traditions, but embraced by new technology. Because it's great, they can make this without any special, they hang it in the grandma's attic, in the old house, but my students can't do that. So I've been working on a method of cold curing, cold chamber curing is what I call it. And I brought one of my noix de jambon that I did in a refrigerator to sort of play against this one.
I chose a noix de jambon because you see here, you have blood. And when you have your arm whole, it's very difficult to imagine in the heart, okay, for the conservation. And now I out.
So if you look at hams in the world where they're made, it's terroir specific. Hams in France are made in the Pyrenees on the leeward side of the mountains, the drier, warmer side. They're made in the Alps, they're made in Spain. In Gascony, it rains. It's too damp, and in addition to problems with slaughter, you know, and knowing the conditions of the animals, we don't have the climate for it. So what people create is called a noix, a nut of ham, and it says a boneless French ham. Even now in the Pyrenees, the Basque country, where they create most of the hams, like Jambon de Bayonne are created, they now have special slaughterhouses to deal with the animals so that they're not just not stressed, but they're never hung. They're always only laid down. Once they've been stunned, they're laid down on a table and blood laying down, and then they go into it. So there's no stress on the joints.
Is there any nitrates in the?
They only have one product that uses nitrates. They use with the jambon de Paris or jambon blanc, a pink ham, sliced ham.
Yeah.
They do use the kind of minimum amount of nitrates, but everything else is just salt and pepper, the saucisson. They don't use any added fermentation. But the pigs, at the age that the pigs are, the pH of the meat is different than the pH of the age.
How old are they?
A year. They take a litter, would be 11 months, 11 and a half months to 13 months. So the average is like a year.
Does he make the dry products all year through?
Yeah. They're smoked, lightly smoked overnight,
okay,
in a chimney, in an old-fashioned chimney, heating up inside and hanging it. And then they're hung upstairs to dry, and then, but except for the saucisson, which put in this fermentation cabinet for a week, and then it goes into a room to dry.
And the temperature in the room is constant enough to use it all year?
Pretty constant. It's about 12 degrees, 72% humidity.
And what are they doing with the bones?
They don't do anything with the bones. They bury them. They compost them on the farm. Otherwise, they have to pay now to have them taken out.
And then you're allowed to?
No stock, no.
It's rats.
Jesus.
No.
Yeah. You have to do that. A lot of compost out of it. If we did that, we went to prison.
It's France.
Yeah. Let's all move to France.
But it's what you're talking about, you know, fighting the legislation to allow you to do things.
Yes,
there. Nothing, you know. There's no value for it. There's nowhere, and stock doesn't exist in French. In French homes, people don't cook with stock. They make soup. You buy the shoulder, you buy it with the bone in, and then you make your soup with that. You don't buy a box of stock. You don't buy chicken stock, you buy chicken. I spent 20 years trying to teach cooking students.
Now you have your four muscles, and I cut just here in the middle, two here. Just one here and one here. I clean, you see why the conservation is very difficult.
What's difficult?
It's
a synovial fluid and that, so I trim all of that off.
And that's for the pâté or?
No, this is, pâté. So when I came to France, I thought pâté was something fancy, it's French, it's a French word, and sausage was like, you know, being an American, sausage, you know, really know what they put in it. And I found out it's the other way around. The sausage is like the best meat, the pâté is everything else. But you ate it last night at dinner, so
it was delicious.
Yeah.
And the pâté recipe, which, you know, I'm happy to send out, it's very easy. It's all the trim you have. And then it's by weight, 10% onions, 10% liver, just a small amount of liver, and 10% potatoes they use as a binder, rather than using eggs or milk.
Boiled potatoes.
Boiled potatoes. And then you salt and pepper, 14 grams salt per kilo and 2 grams pepper. And that's it.
And how's the meat grind? Like what kind of
It's about a 6 millimeter, six to 8 millimeter, pretty large grind, just once.
Why potatoes? Because when people take on the market your pâté, they put in the car and they blah 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 with.
They go to the bar.
They go to the cafe.
And eggs.
Yeah.
It's very dangerous.
Yeah.
And after when they arrive at home, it's possible to take one egg for kilos for preparation.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
After. But for me, it's no problem, just with...
yeah, it was nice. Yeah.
And potatoes are cheaper.
You're doing
cheaper.
It raw. Mm-hmm. You're because that's good, he's selling it raw.
Yeah.
He does sell some raw, because people still have that tradition. They want to go home and put it in jars and process it, water bath it, and have their pantry with their own pate in it. They'll add more salt, they'll add more seasonings, maybe. But they also sell their own pate cooked. They make a ball, like about a 300 grams size wrap in caul fat, placed in a roasting pan, and that's called fricando. And people buy each, you know, buy one ball, but they also put it in a loaf and do the terrine.
What is the best selling product on the market? What's really popular?
Qu'est-ce que c'est le meilleur?
Saucisse.
Quel produit? Saucisse.